Next, we are taking particulate pollutants. Particulate pollutants are minute solid particles or liquid droplets in air. They are present in the vehicle emissions, smoke particles from fires, dust particles from fly ash, and ash from other industries also. Thermal power plants produce a lot of fly ash which remain in atmosphere. Particulates in the atmosphere may be viable or non-viable. The viable particulates are living organisms like bacteria, fungi, molds, algae, etc. And they are minute living organisms. They are dispersed in atmosphere and the cause of a lot of diseases. Normally we find the diseases are caused when the change in atmosphere or weather takes place, because these can survive in such atmosphere more easily and cause a lot of diseases. Human beings are allergic to some of the fungi found in air. They can also cause plant diseases. Non-viable particulates may be classified according to their nature and size. First, we have smoke particulates, which consist of solid or mixture of solid and liquid particles formed during combustion of organic matter. For example, cigarette smoke, smoke from the burning fossil fuels, garbage and dry leaves, oil smoke, they all form smoke particulates. Dust is composed of fine solid particles over 1 micrometer. Micrometer means 10 to the power minus 6 meter in diameter. They are produced during crushing, grinding and attribution of solid materials. Sand from sand blasting, sawdust from woodworks, pulverized coal, cement and fly ash from factories, dust storms, etc. are typical examples of this type of particulate emissions. Mists are usually produced by particles of spray liquids and by condensation of vapors in air. Examples are sulfuric acid mist and herbicide and insecticide. They are used in, to large extent in agriculture in these days. They miss their target and travel through air and form mists. Fumes are generally obtained by condensation of vapors during sublimation, distillation, boiling and several other chemical reactions. Generally, organic solvents, metals, and metallic oxides form fume particles. The effect of particulate pollutants are largely dependent upon their particle size. Airborne particles such as dust, fumes, mist, etc. are dangerous for the human health. Particulate pollutants bigger than 5 microns are likely to lodge in nasal passages, causing cough, cold, etc. Whereas particles of about 1 micron enter into lungs and cause respiratory problems. Lead used to be major air pollutant emitted by vehicles, but these days we are using unleaded petrol in India. Therefore, we have overcome this pollution to large extent. Lead interferes with the development and maturation of lead blood cells. But still in school buses, we are using yellow paints, which consist of lead chromate, and that is source of lead pollution. Even Chinese toys, which use a lot of colors, particularly yellow color toys, contains lead salts or lead chromate, which also cause lead pollution. Next, we are taking smog. The meaning of smog is it is derived from smoke and fog. We have two types of smog. One is called classical smog, another is called photochemical smog. Classical smog is also called London smog, whereas photochemical smog is called Los Angeles smog. Classical smog occurs in cool, humid climate, whereas photochemical smog occurs in warm, dry and sunny climate. Classical smog consists of smoke, fog and oxides of sulfur, sulfur dioxide and small amount of sulfur trioxide also, whereas photochemical smog is formed by the action of sunlight on unsaturated hydrocarbons and oxides of nitrogen. Sulfur dioxide is reducing in nature, therefore it is called reducing smog, whereas oxides of nitrogen are oxidizing in nature. Therefore, photochemical smog is called oxidizing smog, which is much more harmful than reducing smog. Classical smog contains primary pollutants, whereas photochemical smog contains secondary pollutants, which are extremely harmful. Primary smog causes bronchitis and problems in lungs, whereas photochemical smog causes irritation in eyes. Formation of photochemical smog. When fossil fuels are burnt, a variety of pollutants are emitted in the Earth atmosphere. Two of the pollutants that are emitted are unburnt hydrocarbons and oxide of nitrogen, that is nitrogen monoxide. When these pollutants build up to sufficiently high levels, a chain reaction occurs from their interaction with the sunlight, which converts NO into nitrogen dioxide. And a lot of free radicals are generated, which are causes of a lot of respiratory diseases in these days. Nitrogen dioxide in turn absorbs energy from the atmosphere and breaks up into NO and free oxygen. Free oxygen will combine with oxygen, molecular oxygen, to form ozone, which is extremely active and causes a lot of pollution. This ozone reacts with nitrogen monoxide to form nitrogen dioxide and oxygen, and that is responsible for a lot of pollution. Ozone is a toxic gas, and both NO2 and O3 are strong oxidizing agents, can react with the unburnt hydrocarbons in polluted airs to produce chemicals like formaldehyde, acrolein and peroxyacetyl nitrate, which is called PAN. These are the reactions, how they are formed. Methane reacts with ozone to form formaldehyde plus water, and they are further react to form acrolein, CH2CH, CHO and peroxyacetyl nitrate. This is the formula. This is the peroxide linkage. This is a acetyl group, so it is called peroxyacetyl nitrate. Effects of photochemical smog. Both ozone and PAN act as powerful eye irritants. Ozone and nitric oxide irritate the nose, throat, and high concentration may cause headache, chest pain, dryness of throat, cough, and difficulty in breathing. Photochemical smog leads to cracking of rubber and extensive damage to the plant life. It also causes corrosion of metals, stones, building materials, rubber, and painted surfaces. How can we control photochemical smog, which is extremely harmful? If we control the primary precursors of photochemical smog, such as NO2 and hydrocarbon, the secondary precursors, such as ozone and PAN, the photochemical smog will automatically be reduced. Usually, catalytic converters are used in automobiles, and they prevent the release of nitrogen dioxide and hydrocarbons, so they will prevent the formation of secondary pollutants. Certain plants, these are very useful, pinus, juniperus, curarus, pyrus and vitis, can metabolize oxides of nitrogen, and therefore their plantation could help in reducing photochemical smog. This is the diagram which shows how photochemical smog is formed, and it is yellowish in color due to the presence of nitrogen dioxide. So nitrogen dioxide, oxides, other oxides of nitrogen and volatile organic compounds are formed in the vehicles by combustion of incomplete combustion of the fuels, and they form photochemical smog. So photochemical smog occurs where sunlight acts upon vehicles pollutants and generate a lot of reactive species and free radicals, which are extremely harmful for the health of plants, animals and human beings. Stratospheric pollution, formation and breakdown of ozone. Upper atmosphere consists of large amount of ozone, which protects us from harmful ultraviolet radiation, whose wavelength is 255 nanometer, coming from the sun, and if it reaches the earth, it may cause skin cancer. These radiations cause skin cancer, that is melanoma, in human beings. Therefore, they are important to maintain the ozone shield. Ozone in the stratosphere is the product of ultraviolet radiation acting on oxygen molecule and convert them into ozone. This oxygen atom combined to form molecular oxygen. Ozone decomposes to form molecular oxygen and nascent oxygen, but nascent oxygen combined together to form molecular oxygen again. These are the reactions taking place. Oxygen breaks down into nascent oxygen, two atoms. Nascent oxygen combines with ozone, oxygen, to in the presence of ultraviolet light, and generate ozone gas. That is the way how ozone gas is formed in atmosphere. This is the mechanism. Ozone is thermodynamically unstable and decomposes to molecular oxygen, and thus the dynamic equilibrium exists between the production and decomposition of ozone molecules. The main reason for ozone depletion is believed to be release of chlorofluorocarbons in atmosphere, which can also be called as freons or CFC. These compounds are non-reactive, non-inflammable, non-toxic organic molecules, therefore used in refrigerators and air conditioners, in the production of plastic foam, and by electronic industry for cleaning of computer parts. Once CFC are released in atmosphere, they mix with the normal atmospheric gases and eventually reach the stratosphere. In stratosphere, they get broken down with the help of ultraviolet radiation to chlorine free radical and difluorochloro free radicals. The chlorine free radical combines with ozone to form chlorine monoxide free radical plus oxygen gas is formed. Chlorine monoxide reacts with oxygen atom to form chlorine free radical and oxygen is formed. The chlorine radicals are continuously regenerated and cause the breakdown of ozone. Thus, CFC are transporting agents for continuously generating chlorine radicals into stratosphere and damaging the ozone layer. The ozone hole. We must be knowing that near Antarctica ozone hole has been created, and we are going to discuss why it has been formed. Depletion of ozone layer, commonly known as ozone hole, over the South Pole. It was found that unique set of conditions at Antarctica are responsible for the ozone hole. In summer season, nitrogen dioxide and methane react with chlorine monoxide and chlorine atoms, forming chlorine sinks. That is, chlorine radicals are depleted and they do not cause ozone depletion. Whereas in winter, special type of clouds called polar stratospheric clouds are formed over Antarctica, and these clouds provide a surface for chlorine nitrate to be formed. Chlorine nitrate formed gets hydrolyzed on their surface to form hypochlorous acid. And hypochlorous acid decomposes to form OH free radical and Cl free radical, and ozone depletion stops. It also reacts with hydrogen chloride produced to give molecular chlorine. These are the reactions taking place. Chlorine monoxide reacts with nitrogen dioxide to form chlorine nitrate. Chlorine free radical reacts with methane to form methyl free radical and HCl. Chlorine nitrate gets hydrolyzed by water present in polar stratospheric clouds to form HOCl plus nitric acid. Chlorine nitrate also reacts with HCl to form chlorine and nitric acid. When sunlight returns to Antarctica in the spring, the sun rays bombs breaks up the clouds, and HOCl and Cl2 are hydrolyzed by sunlight as given in the following reactions. HOCl gas breaks down into OH free radical and Cl free radical. Chlorine breaks down into chlorine free radicals. The chlorine free radicals thus formed initiate the chain reaction for ozone depletion, and depletion of ozone starts again in the spring season over Antarctica. Effects of depletion of ozone layer. With the depletion of ozone layer, it may lead to aging of skins, cataract, sunburn, skin cancer, killing of many phytoplanktons, damage to fish productivity, etc. Because more ultraviolet rays will reach the earth. It has also been reported that plant protein get easily affected by UV radiations, which leads to harmful mutation of the cells. It also increases the evaporation of surface water through the stomata of the leaves and decreases the moisture content of the soil. So increase in ultraviolet radiations damage paints and fibers, causing them to fade faster.